Oh, bless Jesus.
Yeah.
As you draw me to the word of prayer, please. Thank you, God.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you for loving us, for blessing us. Thank you, dear God, that your forgiveness is greater than our sin.
Thank you.
Your holiness is more power than our will.
Yes.
That you're able to touch us and remain pure. Thank you, Lord, for loving us.
Thank you.
Thank you, God, for meeting us in this place. God, we thank you that you've given us this opportunity to gather here, that we might worship you, or at least be in the place of worship. We pray, oh God, that there's a word that is said that will penetrate our hearts and our minds. That will draw us closer to you, that will shine a light on you, dear God, that will somehow call us from the wilderness of self, that we might walk closely with you. So God, we thank you for this privilege and we thank you for this honor.
Thank you, God.
We thank you, God, that you are yet God. And we pause in your holy presence and we pray that your will be done.
Yes.
Have your way in this place,
we
pray.
God.
For you are awesome, God.
Yes.
There is none like you. You have no equal or opposite.
Yeah.
You stand alone. You alone are divine. And we humble ourselves in your holy presence. It's in the eternal name of him who is yet alive, Jesus, who is the Christ, we do pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Give an honor to Almighty God. He's indeed God Almighty. From everlasting unto everlasting, he is God.
Yeah.
He's God. He's God. From everlasting unto everlasting, he's God. Doesn't matter what we've been through, what we're going through, what we're up against, who's with us or who's against us, he is God.
Yes, he is.
He's God when we're paying attention. He's God when we're drifting. He is God. It really doesn't matter how we feel about it. He is God.
Yeah.
We can convince ourselves that it's just a good story. It's one of many solutions to life. But the truth is, he is God. No matter if we believe the whole gospel or not,
yeah,
he is still God in this place. And we give him honor, we give him glory, because he is God. Yes, he is. And we thank him and we praise him for who he is. I give honor to my angel alone, the Reverend Vivian Wright. Thank God for her. Amen. I thank God for these preachers who are so gifted and talented. You miss Good Friday, you miss something because these people are gifted, they're talented, they're anointed by God to do what they do, and they do it so very well.
Amen.
So I thank God for each and every one of them. I thank God for you. Thank God that you're here, that we can worship and glorify God together. No, for some of us, it's a preamble to dinner. And for others, it's just it's a family outing. But for most of us, we come because we come to love Jesus and worship him. We come because he is God. But it really doesn't matter what got you here. It's just the fact that you are here. And we are in this place where we can magnify Jesus together. So I acknowledge your presence. I appreciate your presence. Thank you for whatever got you here. Thank you for allowing it to do its job. Because I appreciate the fact that you are in this place and we can worship and magnify our God together.
Amen.
So thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir, for being in this place. Amen. But as always, I'm going to invite you and encourage you to come on and see Jesus with me. Because if we can learn to see Jesus, we can make it. Yeah, we can. See, the world many times think Jesus is a crutch. He ain't a crutch. He's a wheelchair. He's a burden. He's the only way we can make it. See, a crutch requires me to do some work. I can't do it. I need one who's going to carry me all the way. And Jesus is that. He is the one who makes a way out of no way. He's the one who holds us up. He fights our battles. Jesus goes before us and stands rear guard. He's our foundation, and he's our overhead. He takes care of us. He does. He takes care of us. And we come to this place to give him honor in this place today. Look, you have your Bibles. Come with me to John. John's Gospel. Make your way to chapter 20. John's Gospel, chapter 20, we're going to begin at verse 11. John 20, beginning at verse 11.
Yeah.
And it reads, "But Mary stood outside by the tomb weeping. And as she wept, she stooped down and looked into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white sitting, one at the head and the other at the feet where the body of Jesus had lain. Then they said to her, 'Woman, why are you weeping?' She said to them, 'Because they have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him.' Now when she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, and did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, 'Woman, why are you weeping? Who are you seeking?' She, supposing him to be the gardener, said to him, 'Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away.' Jesus said to her, 'Mary.' She turned and said to him, 'Rabboni,' which is to say, 'teacher.' Jesus said to her, 'Do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to my Father, but go to my brethren and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God.'
Yeah.
Mary Magdalene came and told the disciples that she had seen the Lord and that he had spoken these things to her."
All right.
Amen. 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 Just for a little while, I want us to consider together, if you will, the thought, life in dead places. The world is hard. Most of us got a past that we are completely proud of. We've been places that we really don't want to admit that we spent time there. We've made choices that we don't want anybody to know that we got duped like that. We find ourselves telling our story in a way that highlight the highlights and avoid all the places where there might be some embarrassment. We don't want folk really to understand that we spent our wheels so long and we haven't gotten any further than this. It's not always our fault, we say, because there is a wind that's contrary to our progress. The enemy fights us, and the man is against us, and the system is built for our destruction, and it's just a whole bunch of stuff that keep us from being all that we know we can be. And we don't always want to tell folk because we're in situations that aren't always working for our good. And when we get ourselves like that and it starts getting heated up a little bit and folks start understanding too much about our story, we get a little bit upset or we just check out. We stop going to the places that make us uncomfortable. Okay. We stop dealing with the truth that calls us to be more than we think we can be. We stop listening to the voices that call call us to the places that are uncomfortable for us, and we start hanging around with folk that tell the same story that we tell. That have the same idea that we have, that smoke the same joint we smoke, that go to the same bar we go to, that go to the same, we start hanging around with people who wear our colors. We want them to be a part of, and we want to be a part of what's going on, because life is hard. But the truth is that what we find is that we're really running from dead places. Places that we're afraid, because there's no light and no life in those places.
Yeah.
We look back and all we see is shame and pain. We don't see that there's life and light back there. Okay. We look around us and we see that every time I go there, to that church, I come out feeling bad. But when I go to the bar, I come out happy. And we find ourselves wanting to go to the place where we feel happy. Rather than the place that calls us to be confronted with who we are.
Come on, Pastor.
So there's situations in life, and all of us got it. Those of us who act more holy than we ought, we got some blind spots in our lives too. And those of us who condemn and look down at other people, the truth is, I can condemn you so good because I don't spend very much time looking at me. But if we just look at us, we will find that there's some places in our lives that we don't really like too good.
Okay, go ahead.
And because these places are dead, when situations happen that we don't expect, it causes some weeping. It creates some hard times in our lives, and we don't always get it. Now, I know that resurrection is about life, and I know that resurrection is about Jesus who was dead is alive again. I know that it's about the victory of life over death, the hope and possibility of going beyond this world to a place where we spend eternity with God, glory to glory. I know it's about that. But life that only comes from life is a half-life. See, all of us started at a place of death, born in sin, shaping in iniquity. And if life can't pull us out of death, then death is stronger than life. So we have to come to the place where we're able to look at what's dead and say there's life that is still there. God is able to bring life out of dead situations. If he can't do that, then the resurrection is a hoax.
Come on, sir.
If he can't pull life out of death, then resurrection is a myth.
Come on, Pastor Preach.
He has to be able to pull life out of death.
Glory.
He has to be able to make life triumph over death.
Yes.
That means that he can speak into my dead situation, and they can live again.
Yes, sir.
And he can find a way to redeem the time and give back that thing and give me a way to look at my past that will encourage and inform my future.
All right.
So if that's possible,
okay.
If that's real, there's a question, at least one question I saw in the text. All of this happened for one question. It's just one question I saw. I saw a question in the text, and it came to me, and I'm going to share it with you. And the question is this. Why did Jesus stay at the tomb?
Okay.
He done walked dead. Mm-hmm. He's out of the grave.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Why is he not on his way back to glory?
Okay.
Why did Jesus stay at the tomb?
All right, make a plan, Pastor.
Why was he there? He had already overcome. Mm-hmm. He had already defeated hell in the grave. Yeah. He's already alive. Why is he still in dead places? Why is he still where death's supposed to be? Why is the living Savior still in the graveyard?
All right, Pastor.
Why is he there?
Glory.
And you see, sometimes when we're afraid to look at dead places, we miss that Jesus is still walking around. When we're afraid to look at what we did wrong, we miss the fact that Jesus is still walking around. think we have dead places. And some of us think dead places is just a way of life.
Okay.
And either way, either case, you're not looking close enough, and you've chosen to stay dead.
All right.
Now, if I just accept death as a part of life, then you know what? I choose to stay dead.
Okay.
And if I just think that I'm alive in every area and there's no dead spots in my life,
right,
then I choose to let those places stay dead, void, and of no good to me.
Come on, sir.
It's only when I can say they're dead, but he can make them live again,
yes,
that's when I can grow. That's when I'm able to move out.
Come on, Pastor.
See, Jesus is in this place. He's in this place of death because we need to see that there is life where dead things were.
Yes.
We need to see that he's able to give life where death is supposed to be. We need to see that he's able to do it. He's able to make it live again.
Yes. Yes.
Jesus is hanging out of the tomb because he knows that we were looked for a dead Jesus before we will look for a living one.
Yes.
We'll look for a Jesus that don't have the power to get free.
All right.
We have a way of returning to dead situations. We have a way of fighting death and living where life is supposed to be. Jesus knew they were going to return to the place of death.
Come on.
Because they expected him to be dead.
Yes.
And they were going to return there. See, many of us, we come to church. We wave holy hands and we even walk the aisle and give our life to Christ. But we don't really expect much from Jesus. We expect him to stay dead.
All right.
We expect a dead Jesus.
Come on.
And we say he could not have moved unless somebody moved him.
Jesus.
That he can't get up on his own. He's dead. He can't move on his own. He's dead. And we think that if some natural being, something within the cosmos doesn't make it happen, it won't happen. It has to be natural. After all, I don't believe in the supernatural. If you don't believe in the supernatural, then you can't believe in a living God. Jesus, while we expect him to be dead, won't stay dead to meet our expectations. He ain't gonna be dead just because I expect him to be dead.
Yeah.
He ain't gonna do nothing because I don't expect him to do anything.
Yeah.
He's not gonna be silent because I don't expect him to speak.
Yeah.
He ain't gonna act dead because I expect him to be dead.
Come on, Pastor.
He is living. And it's only when we are willing to go and look in that situation. The women went and they started to look in the situation. And they were weeping, trying to see a Jesus who's dead.
Glory.
See, if you're not willing to look at that spot, if you're not willing to look while you can't keep a job, if you're not willing to look while you're lonely, nobody won't be your friend. If you're not willing to look while you can't make it work, if you're not willing to look while you can't hold on to a nickel and you spend everything you got, if you're not willing to look, he can't speak life to it. If you're not willing to look, why you feel hopeless? If you're not willing to look like there's no vision, if you're not willing to look, you're like your life is all past and no future. If you're not willing to look, you have to be willing to look.
Yes.
You have to be willing, because if you don't look, you won't see the light.
Come on, Pastor.
You have to be willing to look and see life.
Yes.
And dead places.
Yes.
They were there. And how do I know? Because Jesus asked the woman, why are you crying? And then he said, well, who are you looking for? You see, you have to know what you're looking at, who you're looking for. So many times we go to situations and we look for stuff that when they don't give us life, but we ain't looking for Jesus. No, we're looking for happiness. We're looking for money. We're looking for joy. We're looking for peace. We're looking for the boo. We're looking for the next job. We're looking for the car. We're looking for revenge. We pray. We pray not because we want Jesus. We pray because we want Jesus to be our attack dog. Go get him, Jesus. So we don't pray because we're looking for Jesus. We're looking for stuff that we want Jesus to deal with.
Come on.
So we're missing. Now that's not just you. That's in the text too. That's how the women showed up. That's how Mary showed up. See, they showed up to serve Jesus.
Okay.
They showed up to serve him. Mm-hmm. They were looking to serve him.
Yeah.
They came prepared to serve him.
Yeah.
They got their clothes out the night before. They were ready to go serve Jesus. But they were going to serve the Jesus who's dead.
Come on, come on.
And when they met up and the dead Jesus wasn't there, now they don't know how to serve him. What do I do now? How do I serve him now? I came prepared to serve him. Why I got to try to study and and decode it and decrypt it. Why I gotta go through all that? Just tell me. Just make it obvious. I'm bumping into all the walls. Just hang an exit sign on the door. Just let me go. Have you ever felt like that? Well, you know, I wonder if the women felt like that, because Jesus is obviously already alive.
Already.
The stone has already been rolled away.
Already.
Grave has already been defeated. Hell has already been shown it has no power for Jesus. Death has already been minimized and pushed aside. The women are already, they got to know that Jesus is already alive. Jesus, why didn't you just show up before I left home? Why you let me pack all this stuff? How come you didn't just show up at my house and tell me I'm already alive? You know I'm going to go to the tomb. Why didn't you just come to my house and say, I'm already alive? And that's what we want him to do.
Yes.
And then if he doesn't do that, he's going to send us to talk to some folk that he can talk to himself. You're going to tell me to go to the disciples. All you got to do is go to where they are. You're going to tell them. Why are you going to make me go tell them? Why I got to forgive them? Why I got to help them? Why I got to love them? Why I got to take care of them? Why I got to rescue them? You can do it. Why I got to go through all that? I don't even like them that good. And you want me to do all that? third time, I'm a little slow. After the third or fourth time, I couldn't find the light. I started leaving the light on. So now when I wake up and I'm in a hurry, I ain't got to search. I got to go right home and I'm there. You see, when you go back to those dark places and you start identifying all the time you should have trusted God and all the way, what you do is you turn your lights on. So when you go back and you look at it, you don't just see dark and scary no more. You see that God was there all the time, there with you, watching over you, protecting you, so you don't get stuck the next time. Turn some light on in your past. Turn some light on in your failure. Turn some light on in your disgrace. Turn some light on. See the hand of God. He brought you through. See, that's why you got to seek him. That's why Jesus asked the woman, said, well, who do you seek?
Who are you looking for? Yes.
Go tell my brethren to meet me over there because they got to come seek me too.
Come on.
They need to come and find me.
Yes.
And that's what I'm saying to all of y'all who used to be in and now you done slipped out. The devil has scratched you out. You used to come to church, but you only came to church. You never came to the Lord.
Come on.
See, I'm talking to all of y'all who, and all of us. Our parents made us come. But as soon as we think we got old enough, I ain't got to go no more.
Come on, Pastor.
All of us.
All of us.
You need to turn some light on.
Turn the light on.
You need to look around and see where you really are.
Turn the light on.
You know, have you ever saw the bar you go to in the daylight? Have you ever saw the bathroom of the bar you go to in the daylight? And you have such a good time in all that filth. Have you ever counted up how much money you done paid on liquor, tobacco, and go? How much money you paid in the Uber trying to get to the club? Church and cut somebody out. That's why you can take
sick.
So you ask yourself, why are you just as mean today as you were 10 years ago, and you go to church quite often? It's because you just come to church. There needs to be a relationship. A surrendering. And when you surrender to him, he calls you by name. And then you say, Rabboni.
Yeah.
Now, side note, this is Mary Magdalene. Mm-hmm. The world wants you to believe that Jesus and Mary Magdalene had a thing.
No, they haven't.
If they did, they must have broke up. Because right here, Jesus says Mary. And she don't say, yeah, boo. She don't say, hey, baby. He calls her Mary.
Okay,
and she turns and says, Rabboni.
Yeah.
Teacher.
Yeah.
Master.
Yeah. Okay.
That ain't no pillow talk. That ain't love talk right there. That is one surrendering and submitting themselves to the authority of their life. That's what relationship is. So women, stop running around talking about I'm married to Jesus. You ain't married to Jesus. Jesus is Lord. He's not your husband. He's not your man. He's not your boo. He's your master. He's your Lord. He's your Savior. He's your master. So it's less, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. That's what she did. And Jesus pretty much told her this.
Okay.
Stop crying.
Okay.
And go do what I told you. See, when we get to the place where we have enough confidence in Jesus and his love for us, and he just tells us to stop crying over all the broke places in our lives. Stop crying that your daddy dropped you. Stop crying that your mama didn't take care of you. Stop crying that you lost your job. Stop crying that your husband left you. Stop crying. I ain't saying it don't hurt. I ain't saying that it's not painful. I'm not saying that they were wrong for doing it. What I'm saying is, as long as you cry over it, you're stuck and they're still in charge. It's not till you say, I ain't crying no more. I'm going on. I'm going to trust Jesus. I'm going on. I'm going to trust the Lord. That's when you get victory. Jesus says, stop crying and go.
And go.
Yes.
Stop crying and go.
Jesus.
Now, they say that pride and what's that word? Low self-esteem.
Mm-hmm.
It's really two sides of the same coin.
All right.
It's really, pride is an outward expression of some kind of anger or something you're covering. And then depression or low self-esteem is when you take that anger and turn it on self.
Yes.
Because it's the same motivating factor. It's just one is expressed inward and the other one expressed outward.
That's right.
That's what they say. Well, you know, those who cry over the past and those who act like they have no past,
oh,
it's the same motivating factor.
Oh, my goodness.
You're afraid of the past.
Oh, my goodness.
So if you can stand up and act like Jesus really is not that significant in your life,
okay.
I do not think I'm better than the person who cried mm-hmm. over Jesus not showing up in their life.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's the same motivating factor.
All right.
We miss Jesus.
Okay.
And we do it on our own.
Come on.
So what I'm saying, and what I hope you get, is that Jesus will give life in dead places.
Yes.
If you realize he's still at the tomb.
Yes.
If you go and you look at that situation, he will speak life. And you don't have to be afraid of it anymore.
Yes.
Brother, you can be able to raise your hand and say, I love the Lord, and not feel as though somebody might think there's something wrong with you.
Come on, Pastor.
Sister, you can say, I love the Lord, and don't have to worry about if you got a man next to you or not.
Come on.
It's only when we can trust Jesus.
Hallelujah.
So what I'm saying to us, y'all, please.
Glory.
Please hear me. Please hear me. Please. If you haven't listened to nothing else, perk up. Listen to this right here. Without Jesus, you stay dead.
Glory. Mm-hmm.
Even if you don't realize that you're dead already.
Right. Yes, sir. Yes.
Without him, you stay dead.
Glory.
Even if you don't realize. But the flip side of that is, with him, no matter how dead you are or have been, he can cause you to live.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
But it requires relationship.
Relationship.
He gives life in dead places.
Yes, he does.
That's, there's more. And for those of you who don't come to church often, I'm going to preach every bit of it. Now listen. Understand this way. But if you're here and you've not accepted Jesus Christ as your first Lord and Savior, come on and do that today. Don't leave this place going back to that same dead situation but not someone who can give you life and turn the lights on for you.
Glory.
Let us stand. If you're here and you want to accept Christ as Lord and Savior, will you come and do that? Will you come and give your life to him?